Are you ready to use Excel like a pro? In this series, I'll be taking you through the most important Excel concept, from absolute reference to XLOOKUP, from pivot table to power pivots, which will cover 80% of what actually you use on Excel. Before I jump in, make sure to hit the like button and do subscribe so that you don't miss out the latest tutorial from analytics everywhere. And if you like this video, then do share with someone who are looking to elevate their Excel skills. Now let's dive into the first concept. The first one is absolute reference. Now, what is absolute reference? It's nothing but a cell locking you do on Excel function and formula. How does that work? Let me show you. We have a table which has a month, quantity, and amount. We need to get the remaining amount based on the quantity and amount available on the row number 2. Now it's a simple divide, right? If you divide by amount by quantity, it gives you the value per quantity or the amount per quantity, whatever you say. Now based on this value, I need to get the remaining amount over here. It's very simple, right? You just need to get the quantity, which is from the column B, and then you need to just multiply 6, right? Which is our amount per quantity. And once you do that, you copy the formula and you paste it. But you are getting a 0 over here. Why? Because we have not done the absolute reference or the cell locking over here. How do you do that? It's very simple. You go here on the formula, double click on that, and you get a B3, multiply by F2. Now, F2 is our the cell which we need to lock, right? What is the easiest way to do that? You go and you click on F4, and you see the dollar sign over here, which is beside the F and beside the 2. It means that it is locked. And once you do that, you copy and you paste your formula, and you get the details over here. And this is what we call cell locking. And I'll show you also in the remaining function that how does this cell locking or the absolute reference impact your function or formula. Now we have a table which has region, quarter, and sales. Now region, we have east, west, south, and north. We have quarter of Q1, Q2, Q3, and Q4, and sales in lakhs. Now the task is to get the total sales amount for every region. What is the way to do that? We can apply something called SUMIFS. Now it is a combination of SUM and IFS. Okay. We start with equal to, and then we'll just write SUMIF. And once you write that, you get two options. One is SUMIF and one is SUMIFS. The difference is that the SUMIF can take a single argument, whereas SUMIFS can take multiple arguments. Now it's always better to use SUMIFS because if you need it, then you can apply multiple argument of the criteria over here. Now, the first one is to sum range. Now, my sum range is sales, which is column C. I'll just go here. And remember, we have already learned about the absolute reference or the cell lock. What you need to do, you need to press F4 and it is locked because we need for north, east, and south as well. And then the next one is my criteria range 1, which is what? My column A, the region, because we are going to filter on region east. And again, I am going to lock that. And then next, I'll just select my east from the F2. And once you do that, and we don't need to lock over here on the F2 because I'm going to drag and drop. And once you drag and drop, the F2 will become F3, F4, F5, so on and so forth. Okay. And once you click on that, you close the parentheses and you enter, you get your entire sum. How do you check that number is correct or not? Let's apply a filter, Control Shift L, and then you go here and you select for east, and we'll just see, and we'll see sum over here, which is 3370, and our number is 3370, which is, it is working fine. Now what do you just need to do? Just need to copy the number. You just copy and paste, and boom, you get every number over here. How do you check that the entire process is, or the entire sum is correct or not? My entire sum is 8910. Now let's see, if I go here and select, which is 8910. So it is correct. The second part of this, if in case you need only for quarter one, now we need quarter one number, right? But in case this is a very huge data and you don't know how to get the quarter one number, or you are not able to find out, in that case, what you can do, you can write another SUMIF functions over here. And in Here we are going to use multiple criteria over here, right? The first one is sum range always, remember. So apply the sum range and you can log that if you're bringing it for another region or another criteria. Then the criteria range one, my criteria range over here, first one is always a region. Now I can F4 and I can select the region from here because it has to match the name. Always remember the East should always match with the spelling of East. The capital letter or small letter really matters over here. Okay. And now the second criteria, it should be my quarter. So I'll just go ahead and select and I lock that. And here I'm going to say my Q1. Now I'm doing a hard coding over here on the Q1 over there. And once you click on that, you get 990, which is matching with our sale number or the overall sum in sales in the table. Now we have this table which has a region, quantity and the sales, right? But we have got the region name and the quantity, but we don't have the sales number. What we can do, we have already used the region wise sales, right, which is this table. Now we can use this table and get our data over here using VLOOKUP. Now VLOOKUP is one of the most important function in Excel, and it's a most used function in Excel. So let me show you how you can use a VLOOKUP and can get the data. But before that, let me just rename this and make it a table for you so that you understand it properly. Let me say this is total sales and once region. Now let me use apply my VLOOKUP. So equal to, and you say VLOOKUP. The first one is the lookup array. Now you select the region as a lookup array and the next part is a table array. Now I'll go here and I select my entire table. So you can select from the region, from the name to the end, or you can only select from East to the end of the data. So it does not really matter. And then once you do that, make sure to lock the table because we are going to use that again and again. And we don't want to really come back and change the references if we don't lock it, right? And then third part, which is a column index number, right? This is a little catchy. Just try to remember, if you are using a table and if you are referencing your first column with your lookup value, right, then your first column is your number one column and second column is your number two column, so on and so forth. So in our case, what we need is a total sales number, right, which is our second column. So we'll say 2. And then at the end, approximate match or exact match. Always go for exact match. If you don't really have a case of approximate match, either you can write 01, you can select, or you can select a false true from here. You close the parentheses and you click enter. You get your number, which is 3370, which is matching with the number we have. Now, the easy way to drag and drop your formula, that you can just go here on this corner, and once your mouse turn into a cross of a black, you just drag and drop or double click on that, and it gives you the entire number, which is again 8910 and which is matching with our number. We have already worked with VLOOKUP, right? Now we are gonna try to use something called XLOOKUP, which is a new version of VLOOKUP, and I'll show you why you need a XLOOKUP over VLOOKUP and why VLOOKUP is not always sufficient for your case. Now let's look at this data. We are going to use this data for XLOOKUP. Now, if you don't know, or you have no idea about this data, then I have already explained this about this data in my last video on SQL series. If you are eager to learn on SQL, if you want to explore this data too, just go and check out from the top. Now let's come back to the XLOOKUP part. This is nothing but your employee data, which has employee ID, the name, then department ID, salary, hired date, and email. Now, what do you want? We want the department name over here. Now, for that, we have a mapping file, which is called department name and department ID. Okay. Now, what is the problem over here? We can just apply a VLOOKUP, right? We can easily apply a VLOOKUP and can get that. But the problem would be, right? That if we try to do that, so let's say if you say VLOOKUP, and what would be your lookup value would be 1, and then the table array would be this, right? And you are gonna apply a cell locking, and the column index would be what? Then your department ID to department name, correct? So either you have to do something called -1 because it's on left hand side, or you can say 2, whatever, like you can try. But what if you try and you say false and you click enter and you get any, because there is nothing called -1. And if you try 2, you get any because there is no 2 available over here. This is the problem, or I would say the limitation of VLOOKUP. And that's where the XLOOKUP comes. Before the XLOOKUP, I think it's been 2 years, if I'm not wrong. Before that, we used to apply something called index match, but right now there is a direct option, which is XLOOKUP, which can help us to get that. Now, XLOOKUP takes a lot of argument. I'll tell you what and how you can use that. The first one is a lookup value. It should be my employee ID, and then my lookup array, okay? Now, we are not gonna actually select the entire table, only the lookup array from where my lookup value should match, right? So this L2 to L5 is my lookup array. I will log that, and then my return array. So if it is match my lookup value to lookup array, then what it should give me as a return? So then this, from this column, it should give me the department ID. And if I say I made a mistake, so though I got my name, but let me just show you how. Okay, I've locked, and the next one is if not found, and I say NA. Now this is an optional, right? If it is in bracket, it means it's optional. You can give it, you can skip it. The match mode. Now here, you got a lot of options like exact match, the exact match on next smaller item, exact match on next larger item, wildcard character. So just go with the exact match. You don't really need all this thing, most of the cases. And this is a very interesting option, which is called search mode. Now search mode is nothing but, let's say you have a duplicate, numbers over here. In that case, this search mode comes into a play, or in any other scenario, you can just select a default by 1. So it will search from top to bottom. And once you click enter, you get HR, right? And if you remember, we have selected the employee ID, but here we should ideally select the department ID. That was a mistake I made. So what I can do, instead of A2, I'll just refer to D2, which is my department ID. So I say HR, and I'll make it a department name. Now, in case, for an example, if I make a changes to 3 to 9 or 7, you see you get NA, because we have already said that if there is no match, then give me an NA, okay? So that's how you can use your XLOOKUP, and it can, overcome the VLOOKUP incapabilities or the limitations. Imagine that you are working in a company and you are part of the HR team, and suddenly from finance team asked you to give the details of the grade of the employee, right? And they share a rules based on that. Okay, what is the rules? The rules is very simple. If someone is earning less than or equal to 50,000, then they are into grade 8, and between 50 to 60 should be grade 9, and then so on and so forth. And if someone is earning more than 70,000, then they are into grade 12. So this very simple rule they have already shared with you and shared this data. Now you already know this data because you already worked with the VLOOKUP cases. You just have to put the grade over here. Now, how to do that? You must be thinking, okay, what is the big deal? Let me copy paste from here, grade 8 for this, and paste it over here, right? Okay, this is fine, you can do that. But imagine that instead of this 21 employee, you have maybe 20,000 employee or, you know, 5,000 employees. Do you really think that you can do it manually? For that, there is something called if and if else, you know, come into the picture and can help you do it automatically through the function. Let me show you how. So what you do, you write if function, and once you do that, you get three arguments, right? One is a logical test. Now, what is logical test? It is nothing but what you compare a number with a number, right? It could be equal to, it could be greater than, could be less than equal to, or greater than equal to. That's what we call a logical test. Here we're gonna do with the E2, which is our salary. And we say if it is less than equal to 50,000, then my value should be grade 8, okay? And if it is not, then I'll just put any for now and see what will happen. We are getting grade 8 over here. And if I do the drag and drop, I get all the NA. Why? Because there is no other salary out there which is less than or equal to 50,000, which is correct. We got the grade 8, but how to get the grade 9 over here? Now, the next part of this function is to nested if or the if else. Now, there is nothing called else here in the Excel. What we use is the if else. And what we say is the if else, but this is actually a nested if. If inside a if. How to apply that? Now, imagine that this logic as if this E2 is true, then give grade 8 as a return, right? If it is true. But what if it is false? What it was giving us? Any. But instead of that, I can define another if function. I would say if this my 50,000 again less than equal to 60 in this case, then it should be grade 9, right? And if not, now I will define as NA once again. And what I do, I will drag and drop and I'll get grade NA, correct? So this is 54,000 and this is grade 9. We got the grade 8 and grade 9, but let me put the, the remaining grade 12. 11 and 10, right? So we can follow the same thing. Instead of NA, you put another if, and then you define the same thing equal to, it should be 65,000. And if it is 65,000, then it should be grade 10. And once grade 10 is done, then you can do the same thing on if it is equal to, let me expand this for you so that if it is equal to 70,000, then it should give us like grade 11, right? So 10 is done. Now this is 11. And the next one, we are not going to write anything. We're just directly going to write a grade 12. Why? Because it is from 0 to 70,000 is covering in between this grade, right? So remaining should be grade 12 only if it is match. Once you click enter, before that, just make sure that you have the parenthesis right and you click enter. Once you do that, you get all the grade, like this is grade 12, which is 78,000 and which is matching with our the rules. Thank you very much for watching, and if you find it valuable, then please do like, share and subscribe. And if you have any questions, any concern, please put it on the comment. I will reply it personally. And for more fresh data content, please do follow me. I'll see you in the next video. Thank you once again. Bye bye.